the East was an interesting company during the 80s and 90s. They weren't as popular or as big as, say, Capcom or Konami, but they still managed to bring out a variety of games that would become popular during those decades. Unfortunately, these underdogs of the video game world would have to file for bankruptcy in 2003, ending their line of titles. Data East's titles weren't always the most original in concept, but they usually would stand out by taking a known formula and adding some weird or unique quirk to it. These quirks were what usually defined their titles to me, and make their outputs very memorable. So today, I'm going to count the top 7 Data East arcade games. Why 7? Because it's better than 11. Number 7, Tumble Pop. This game is Data East's take on the one-screen action puzzle style game similar to Bubble Bobble, Snow Brothers, and Funky Jet. Especially Snow Brothers.
Let's give up.
Let's give up? But we just started.
Let's give up.
Let's beam up? Is Mr. Scott aware of this? Regardless, Tumble Pop has you play as a kid armed with a vacuum cleaner, out to clean the world of baddies! The gameplay with the vacuum cleaner is clever and easy. You use your vacuum to suck up multiple enemies, then release them onto the other baddies and knock them out and make combos for bigger reward. The more baddies you suck up, the bigger and stronger your attack is. Also, having the enemies roll into certain areas will help you find hidden items. The variety of enemies in this game can only be described as random. But hey, let me show you a few real quick. We have Johnny Five, Cannon Spike, Karnov, Shellnov, Thing, Evil Genies, and of course Clowns. Because if a video game has clowns, you can rest assured it'll appear on this show. Whoa, Mr. Dew, is that you? Man, times must have been tough if you're appearing in another company's game as a boss. Then again, last time I saw you was on a slot machine. So I don't know if that's better or worse than this. And that's Tumble Pop. Its gameplay may revolve around a vacuum cleaner, but surprisingly, it doesn't suck. Number 6, Gondomania. You know what you don't see get mixed together much? Ancient Greece / Rome and science fiction. I can only think of like 3 cases of this. The cartoon Ulysses 31, though I kind of think it looks like Space Jesus. Capcom shooter Legendary Wings. And this game, Gondomania. When I was a kid, I thought the title of the game said Gonzomania, and I was upset at the lack of Muppets. Anyways, much like Legendary Wings, Gondomania is a shooter that blends ancient Rome stylings with a lot of science fiction tropes. But that's where the similarities end. In Gondomania, you play as some dude driving a Return of the Jedi-style speeder bike and destroying a lot of Roman soldiers. Hell, it even has a mech of sorts! One of the neat things in the game is the enemies leave coins when you kill them, and you use those coins to buy new weapons, different speeder bikes, armors, and upgrades for your bike. Unlike games like Fantasy Zone where you have to go to a shop to do this, Gondomania just has the items laying around with a price tag on them. If you have the muns, you can fly over them and get the item or upgrade. It's like a weapon drive-thru. These guys were even more advanced than I thought. Also, the weapon system's interesting. You have 2 weapons, one that is specific to the speeder bike you have, and one that is thrown by the rider. The speeder bike weapons are limited and can only be refilled by getting a new speeder bike. The rider's default weapon is an unlimited supply of throwing knives. You can buy other weapons for your rider to use, but they are all limited. The neat thing is buying a weapon for the rider doesn't replace the weapon he currently has, instead it stacks the weapons on top of each other. So if you grab some ninja stars and then grab some grenades, your rider will use the grenades until they run out. Once that happens, then he'll start using the ninja stars until they run out, to which he'll then go to the default weapon of the throwing knives. It's really neat and it's very different from anything I've seen in a shooter, and you can stack quite a few weapons on top of each other, which is pretty cool. I also like how you can still control the speeder bike and collect gold even after you die. Not even death can stop me from getting my monies. I also like how everyone, yourself included, turns into light upon being killed. It's a really neat effect. I guess you could say this game takes life lightly? Huh? Number 5, Nitro Ball. What happens when you take Smash TV and mix it with a pinball machine? A Smash TV pinball machine. Or maybe Nitro Ball. Nitro Ball is absolute insanity. You're a contestant in a life-threatening game show where the show floor is set up like a variety of pinball machines. When you shoot an enemy, they roll around on the playing field, allowing you to push them into bumpers, targets, and other pinball-like obstacles, allowing you to score more points, weapons, and wonderful prizes. Stuff like cars, planes, flamethrowers, you know, the usual stuff. And if you get the B power up, your guy will literally turn into a pinball and bounce around, taking everyone out with him. There's also a wide variety of tables to play on, such as... Just to name a few. Is that the Baja Bugger? Man, guess you didn't get any work after up and down. Regardless, Nitro Ball is such an amazingly weird and inventive run-and-gun game. It's a real pity this game ended up being so obscure, because it's so awesome on a multitude of levels. I highly recommend you guys check this game out. I'm sure you'll have a ball. Oh yeah, that's the stuff. Number 4. Windjammers. What's more amazing than someone making a game out of playing with a frisbee? The fact someone was able to make one this intense! Windjammers is like you mix frisbee with soccer and pong and just gave it one big adrenaline shot. I can't even think of a game that ever got my blood pumping as much as this game. In this game, your character and their opponent stand in what looks like a miniature soccer field, each attempting to try to get their frisbee into the other opponent's goal. You can skid across the ground, throw the frisbee in multiple directions, or even a curved arc. And if you block a frisbee thrown into your court and catch it fast enough, you can perform a super move. There's not much else to say about this game other than it's one hell of a hectic and fun experience. It also makes for a fantastic multiplayer game. And hell, even the one-player mode is a lot of fun, but I'll warn you, the AI can get absolutely ruthless. Expect to lose again and again and again. Oh my god, I actually won this time! Yes! Number 3, Atomic Runner Chelnov, Nuclear Man, The Fighter. Data East? You really need to work on your English. That title is nonsensical at best. You probably would have been better off saying The Nuclear Fighter. Granted, I guess it's not much worse than the literal Japanese translation of Fighting Human Power Plant. In an event Data East swears wasn't inspired by the Chernobyl incident, Chelnov was a coal miner who got stuck in a nuclear explosion that gave him superpowers. Superpowers that allow him to only run forward unless he's fighting a boss. Out to stop an evil organization in what looks to be the weirdest post-apocalyptic world this side of Adventure Time, Chelnov breaks out of some capsule and becomes the father of endless runners everywhere. Atomic Runner Chelnov is such a crazy, weird, and unique game that it instantly got my attention when I found it at a local bowling alley as a child. The gameplay is set up as auto-scrolling levels, and Chelnov can only run forward or stop, and absolutely can't go in the opposite direction. So you have to run, jump, and collect power-ups while keeping in mind that you can only go forward. It makes for an addictive, hyper, and unique gameplay style. However, since enemies will try to sneak behind you, Chelnov does have the ability to turn around and attack things, though he'll keep running forward. I guess one of Chelnov's superpowers is being incredibly adept at running backwards, because it sure ain't strength since he dies in one hit. Though he must have a lot of endurance considering he's constantly running throughout the game. In fact, the only time you can move Chelnov to the left is when you're fighting a boss, since boss battles take place in a single screen. Another thing that makes the game fun is the wide variety of weapons that you can find, like laser guns, morning stars, fire wheels, and my personal favorite, boomerangs! That's my personal rule in video games. Boomerangs are always the best weapon. What's really awesome is how weird and crazy the landscape and enemies are in this game. My favorite thing has to be the evil sock puppet. Cecil, the C6 Sea Serpent? Is that you? Man, you haven't aged well at all. I'll play this cartoon. The only thing more bizarre is the Genesis version, simply named Atomic Runner. Seemingly, the nuclear explosion and main character's name made people feel that Data East was mocking the horrible Chernobyl incident. So while the Genesis port is essentially the same game, they changed the story to revolve around Chelnov using a power suit to save his sister, Chelny. I'm not kidding, that's what her name is. From evil ancient aliens. Because of this, the graphics are changed to fit a Mayan Inca-style ancient civilization of sorts, which makes things kind of surreal since the enemy placement, gameplay mechanics, and layout are the exact same as the arcade, just with different graphics. I mean, for example, look at this. I like a good Kukulkan as much as the next man, but it just doesn't have the same effect as an evil sock puppet. Number 2. Magical Drop 3. Oh, Lordy Lou, the hours I spent with this game, I don't even want to try counting them. Not only is Magical Drop 3 my second to favorite Data East game, it's my absolute favorite puzzle game. Starting the craziest take on the Arcana ever, you race against another player to match as much color spheres as possible. What separates this from other color matching games is that instead of dropping pieces into a pile, you instead have a pile of pieces that are slowly dropping down on your character. To get rid of the pile, you must grab pieces from the pile and rearrange them to where three or more match, erasing them from existence. Also, unlike most puzzle games, there's actually two ways to beat your opponent. See, while there is some strategy in this game, Magical Drop 3 is less focused on strategy and more focused on matching the orbs as fast as you fucking can. So speed is of the essence with this game. So you can win the traditional way of making multiple combos or clearing large areas, which of course drops more lines on your opponent, speeding up their demise, thus allowing you to win in the traditional puzzle game fashion of merely outlasting your opponent. The other method of winning is there's a counter in the middle that decreases the more spheres you eliminate. The first person to reach zero will also win the round. My favorite character in this game is Death. I never expected Death to be so adorable and punk. She looks sinister, but so damn adorable at the same time, I just want to hug her. And I also love Justice, who loves to toot her own horn. And Strength, who is, in fact, a girl. And for you perverts out there, we also have the oh-so-busty World. Calm yourself down, girl. I'm kind of afraid you're going to knock yourself out with those things. And for you S&M fans out there, there's Empress. Ah, kumbaya!
Terrific!
So yeah, Magical Drop 3 is a fast, furious, and impossible game to, well, drop. And the number one Data East game is Burger Time! I fucking love this game! Not only is it my favorite Data East game, it's one of my all-time favorite games, period! I just fucking love this thing! Burger Time encompasses my favorite aspect of early 80s arcade games, taking a relatively simple idea and exaggerating it to such an abstract level that you manage to just make this amazing game out of it. Put it simply, in Burger Time you're a chef making hamburgers, but they're giant hamburgers, so big that you have to walk on parts of the hamburgers to make them drop to the plates at the bottom of the level. And these are some really fucking big burgers. This is like the ultimate super size in here, mofo. But things can't be easy, nope. Some of the food at your restaurant has literally gone bad. So bad, they're out for blood. These murderous foodies are the creatively named Mr. Hot Dog, Mr. Egg, and Mr. Pickle. And they're out for your butt. Also, is it me, or is Mr. Egg some creepy Cyclops monster? He's got, like, that one eye that stares into your soul. As if he's saying, "You fried me, motherfucker. You fucking fried me!" This game was also memorable to me for having a commercial that gave me fucking nightmares when I was a little kid.
We are closed now!
Fortunately for us, and the chef, whose name is Peter Pepper, we have a few ways to defend ourselves. Peter Pepper has a limited supply of, well, pepper. He can use it to temporarily stun the baddies. He can also lead them onto pieces of burger that he's walking on and drop them down to a few levels below with the burger piece. This will also both score you multiple bonus points and drop the burger down an extra level. He can also squish the baddies by dropping the hamburger pieces on top of them, giving the customers a little extra substance into their burgers. Though I really hope they didn't ask me to hold the pickles. Burger Time is simple, but extremely challenging and addictive experience. I've been playing this game since I was like 6 years old and I've never stopped. It's only a shame that none of its sequels ever came close to the majesty of this game. And with that said, I deem Burger Time the best game made by Data East. Though, personally, I'm hungry. I think I'm gonna eat a pizza. Yeah, I bet you thought I was gonna say burger, didn't you? Ha ha ha!